Hey guys, welcome back to our channel. It's your girlfriend Elungu back with another reaction video. If you're new to this channel, make sure to give this video a thumbs up, share it with a friend, and of course do not forget to subscribe. Like I said, my name is Fanny Lungu, and on this channel we post reaction videos each and every day. So if there's something that you guys want us to react to, let us know by dropping the link in the comment section below. We'll do it for you. You can also check out our second YouTube channel called Fanny and Jesse 2.0, our podcast Diving In with Fanny and Jesse, our Patreon Fanny and Jesse. You can find the links to those in the description box. A big shout out to everyone that has subscribed to our channel so far. Thank you very much. I hope you guys are doing all right and may you stay blessed. A big shout out to the person that suggested this. So today I'm going to be reacting to Must Watch Part 3, False Fathers, Adnan Rashid versus Christian Speaker's Corner. So without wasting time, let's get into the video.
With some tax and
yes, I think you are. Most Christians are.
And what you did, you know, and you pointed out one specific text that supports your argument, and I believe I understand why it says that, but obviously we don't agree on that.
But when we take, no, but it dismantles the idea that Jesus can be God.
Well, when we take the whole of the text and we look at everything that Jesus said, including that passage in Revelation that I mentioned, where he says, "I am the Alpha and the Omega, the Almighty."
Okay, I know of all these verses.
Then,
can you produce one direct statement? Well, just a simple question.
Yes.
One direct statement where Jesus said, "I am God."
Well,
simple. Jesus, look, wait.
Everything was made by him.
I know all of these. I mean, I look, believe me, I have been studying the Bible for the last 10 years. At least last 10 years.
I believe you.
Okay.
I believe you.
There are many statements in the Bible where the Christians come along and they say, "Oh, look at that. Look, it means that he was God. He must be God. He must be God."
Only God can pay for your sins.
Exactly. So you know, it's inference. You're making an inference, right? You're making an inference. You have to use vague, ambiguous.
No.
Okay, wait. Let me. That's why I'm asking for an explicit verse in the Bible where Jesus, look, Jesus went to the tree to curse it. Jesus said to the Pharisees that you are vipers, adulterous generation, you deceivers, you liars, you hypocrites. He had all these things to say. He could have a dialogue with a Samaritan woman. Okay, he could say all these things. One sentence, "I am God. I am God."
Jesus, Abraham was, "I am."
It's not quite saying I'm God. If Jesus wanted people to believe he's God, why is he playing this game? If I want you to know that I'm an engineer, would I go and start fixing a car in front of you and start climbing a pole and start fixing the pole so that you actually... Hold on a second. This guy must be an engineer, okay, for me. I may not be an engineer. I may be a liar. I may be faking. Wait. I'm trying to make a point. If I get into the underneath the car and start fixing it, that doesn't necessarily prove...
He performed many miracles as a sign. That
so did other prophets. Moses performed miracles. David performed miracles. Other prophets performed miracles. It proves nothing. The point I'm making is, if Jesus wanted people to believe that he was God, instead of cursing the Pharisees as vipers, adulterers, and hypocrites, and cursing the tree...
What about being resurrected from the dead?
Look, I'm saying...
Come on.
Are you going to give me a list of things...
God can raise a man who's been dead 3 days.
Only God can make a statement, "I am God." Why didn't he do that?
And what did he
Simple
say?
As that.
What did he say? Moses, this dead wood became snake. So dead thing...
Only God can do that. Only God can do that. Amazingly, Moses is the only person. Amazingly, Moses is the only person who is called God in the Bible.
Satan was called.
No.
Exodus.
Okay. Pardon. I'm talking about humans. I'm talking about Moses. Okay. Did you know Moses? Exodus chapter 1. Okay. Moses was told by God that "I have made thee, or I have made you a God to Pharaoh."
Elohim to Pharaoh.
Is there? If anyone had the right to claim divinity, it would have been Moses. But Moses, far from it, he confirms monotheism of the previous prophets. Shema is clearly documented there in the book of...
That actually has a plurality to that word.
Which one? Elohim?
Israel.
Yeah, so this is plurality of majesty.
It's plurality
It's when Queen Elizabeth says, "We," that's a plurality of majesty, not plurality of persons.
What hope do we have for forgiveness for our sins?
We, as Muslims, have a guarantee for salvation. A lot of Christians have this misconception. A lot of American Christians, I mean, because Christianity is big. It's in Australia, it's in Canada, it's in the US, in South America. A lot of Christians are told by their pastors and their priests that the Muslims are poor souls without any promise of salvation. They are doomed. Unless they believe in the Christ or in his sacrifice, they are doomed. And not quite. Is the case is completely the opposite. Why? Because we have a direct promise from God that so long as we die Muslims, we will have salvation. Eventually, we will end up in paradise. We will be in the under the shadow.
The shedding of blood is
no,
forgiveness
for no, sin, right? No. We don't believe that. We believe you can simply turn to God. God is not deaf, dumb, and blind. God is not like humans. God is powerful. God is all hearing. He knows when we're talking right now. He knows we're talking. And those leaves are moving. He knows they're moving, right? So if I turn to God, I say, please forgive me. I've sinned. He is forgiving. He's merciful. And that's what God tells us in the Quran. There's a verse in the Quran which clearly states that, O Muhammad, tell those of my slaves who have transgressed against their souls, who have sinned, tell them to ask me for forgiveness. Do not despair for my mercy. Do not despair for my mercy. Ask me for forgiveness and I will forgive them. So long as we are repentant, we will be forgiven. Okay? And in Islam, salvation is very straightforward. It's very simple. Like Jesus Christ, you know, had taught his companions, you want salvation, follow the law. In the book of Matthew. Okay? So all these things you guys believe in today as Christians, you are actually followers of Paul, the Apostle Paul. You follow him over Jesus Christ. Because I can show you direct contradictions between Paul and Jesus and his direct disciples.
I was just going to say, you know, as far as forgiveness goes, the problem is with all of us, God is a righteous, holy God. And with any sin or any disobedience to law, there needs to be consequences.
I know
and
all
order,
of this.
In order for God to forgive
and
us.
And who said that to you?
No, but what I'm saying, in
it's
order
Paul,
for God, okay,
Paul.
Okay, but in order for God to forgive us, okay, and we have sinned against.
This is Paul's theology. I don't accept it.
We have sinned against.
Show me where one of the prophets said that a man has to come down and die on the cross for his sin. Isaiah didn't say anything like that.
He talked about
it. Doesn't
Christ.
Say anything like about Christ. I know Isaiah 53. I've read it. I've read commentaries on it, by the way.
Correct. Sorry.
No, okay. I am well aware of these things.
I was just going to say, we've all sinned against a perfectly righteous, perfectly holy God. And in order for that wrong to become right, it had to be a perfectly righteous, perfect, holy sacrifice.
No,
and that's
who
what
said
nothing,
that?
Nothing by the
no,
blood
who said
of,
that?
The blood of Jesus.
Lamb.
No, who said that? Who came up with these ideas? It's all Paul.
The red heifer.
No,
the Jews.
Okay. I'll ask you a simple question. Good Christians.
How do you cry?
Wait. Good Christians.
Sorry? Why are you crying?
Wait.
You're crying for God.
As good Christians, do you follow the Jewish law?
No.
You don't follow the Jewish law?
The moral aspect of it.
Yeah, no, I mean the practical aspect of it. You don't follow it. Did Jesus follow it?
Yes.
He followed it. Right, good. Now we're talking. Who asked you to not follow it?
Paul.
Let them answer the question. They know. Who asked you to not follow it? Simple question, you're
also
silent.
Nobody was justified by the law.
No. I'm asking a simple question.
Okay.
Who asked you to not follow it?
We're not justified by works of the law.
I'm not asking that question. I'm asking you a simple question. Who asked you, the Christians, to not follow the law?
I know the answer you're looking
for. Yeah, what is the answer?
But do you believe that Paul's writings are not inspired then?
I believe Paul went against Jesus and his disciples. And the book of Acts,
the Hebrew roots movement is exactly the same.
And the book of Acts,
it's a common thread.
No, wait.
I believe the same thing.
Have you read the book of Acts?
Yes.
Have you read all of it?
Yeah.
Have you read it carefully? Was there a dispute between Jesus Christ, between the disciples of Jesus and Paul?
Peter and Paul.
Who did Paul dispute with in the book of Acts? Directly. And what was the issue at hand? What was the problem?
Peter, circumcision.
No, circumcision was one point.
Right.
What was the accusation against Paul?
Basically, they were telling believers that they had to get circumcised to follow Christ and not eat pork.
Yeah, yes. But what was Paul accused of? Why did they try to kill him? And what did James tell him in return? You know who James was? Who was James?
Brother of Jesus.
Who was closer to Jesus, James or Paul?
In what way? In what sense?
Spiritually, physically.
Well, Paul had a huge conversion, you know, on the road to Damascus.
I'm asking, who was closer to Jesus? Who would have known Jesus better?
Well, James.
James. Right. If you had Paul in front of you, be very honest. Today, if you had Paul in front of you and James in front of you, out of the two, who would you follow?
The apostle to the Gentiles.
If you had to choose
Peter was the apostle to the Jews.
Yes, no problem. I'm asking about Paul and James. If Paul and James came in front of you today, and you had the choice to follow one of them because they obviously conflicted, who would you follow?
I wouldn't say they conflicted.
I'll show you how they conflicted.
They had disputes, but I wouldn't say they conflicted.
Yeah. Okay. No problem. In their dispute, who would you rather follow? When they disputed, when they disagreed on a point, who would you rather follow?
I personally love Paul because he's my apostle.
That's it. That's the point. No, that is the point. You would ignore a man who spent his lifetime with Jesus, who knew Jesus. Wait, let me finish. He didn't believe.
Not to start with.
So.
It was only after Jesus was resurrected that James believed.
Okay. No. James was the leader of the Jerusalem church.
Yeah, after Jesus' resurrection.
Where did you get that from?
That's the truth.
Where?
It says in
Show me.
The Bible, Jesus' brothers, they didn't... His
family. Show me where it says James was actually not one of the early disciples of Jesus Christ. Show me. I'm curious. I want to know.
It says in... I don't know. I'll have to Google.
People make that inference, I think, when they said that your mother and brother...
His own family.
So it's an inference.
Yeah.
It's an inference. Okay. I'll tell you why the inference is made.
Because they saw the risen...
Okay. My question is simple. Why would you follow a man who never met Jesus, never spent time with him?
He did on the road to Damascus.
No. Who claims that? Who told you that?
The scripture.
No, Paul. You see, you came to believe that Paul's writings are scripture. Although, initially, the early church fathers didn't believe that. They simply called them memoirs of the apostles. The problem is most Christians who walk around with Bibles in their hands, preaching to Muslims and others, have no idea what the history of the scripture is. Wait. The writings of Paul in the first 2 centuries were not even considered scripture.
Do you know why I believe them? Because they're alive inside me.
Okay, that's a very emotional thing to say.
It's not emotional.
And that's a very subjective thing. I don't know what's inside you. You could be inspired by the devil. You could be possessed by the devil. Who knows? Who knows? Seriously.
No tree bites fruit. Though.
Sorry? Of course, Noah, tree bites fruit. So,
what my brother David saying, you know, I was raised in a Christian home. I had some seeds planted.
Yeah.
But I say this, it wasn't until I humbled myself and I read this book, and I was actually seeking God, asking Himself to reveal Himself to me.
Sure.
That it became real in such a way that an intellectual understanding of a text became experiential and real.
I understand.
And it was only after I humbled myself and realized that I know nothing in terms of...
Sorry, guys, do you mind we move down because there's someone smoking here and then...
Anyways, sorry. I think we have to...
Carry on, no problem.
Yeah, but...
The cameraman,
But this is, you know, a true believer has had that experience take place, and it's no longer just texts that we're pulling out.
Being born again.
I understand.
And it becomes real experience.
I'm aware of these things. And I really appreciate the fact that you guys are very diligent and you are, you know, dedicated to your religion. And I see love in you guys for your religion. And I see the love you have for humanity. I don't deny it. I don't reject it. I'm one of those people. And likewise, we have love for you. As Muslims, we are taught to love you, not to hate you. And this is one of the reasons why we're here. We are here for the same reason you guys are here. Because you love humanity, You know, you want to make sure that you share the gospel with them, right? We are doing the same thing. We are here so that we can share the word of the Quran. We believe firmly that the Prophet Muhammad was the true Prophet of God. He was.
I really love how this conversation is going, because they're really trying to get deep with whatever they're talking about, which is better than what I've reacted to before. I mean, a few things that I've reacted to before concerned when it comes to the speaker's corner. It's good that they're giving each other chance and there's respect. And one thing that I picked up from the guy at the far end is he said, when it comes to God, you have to humble yourself. He humbled himself to do whatever he was doing. But what I'm trying to say is, you really have to humble yourself if you want to learn things in life. If you want to learn school, if you want to learn the Bible, the Quran, whatever it is, religion, whatever you want to learn in life, you really have to humble yourself so that you can open up to whatever it is. And at the end of the day, you end up submitting to, if we're going to talk about religion, you end up submitting to God, because you're finding that one thing that you're looking for. Maybe you're not even looking for it, but passages may lead you to that. Let me get started with the second part of this video.